Yesterday, when I was young, the taste of life was sweet as rain upon my tongue. I teased that life as if it were a foolish game, the way the evening breeze may tease a candle flame. The thousand dreams I dreamed, there's plenty things I planned. I always built, alas, on weekend shifting sand. I lived by night and shunned the naked light of day. And only now I see how the years ran away. Yesterday, when I was young, so many drinking songs were waiting to be sung. So many wayward pleasures lay in store for me, and so much pain my dazzled eyes refused to see. I ran so fast that time and youth at last ran out. I never stopped to think what life was all about. And every conversation I can now recall concerned itself with me, me, and nothing else at all. Yesterday, the moon was blue, and every crazy day brought something new to do. I used my magic age as if it were a wand, and never saw the waste and emptiness beyond. The game of love I played with arrogance and pride, and every flame I lit too quickly, quickly died. The friends I made all seemed somehow to drift away, and only I am left stage to end the play. There are so many songs in me that won't be sung. I feel the bitter taste of tears upon my tongue. The time has come for me to pay for yesterday, when I was young. Young. Young.
What's it mean to come back here and see not just guys you raced with, but friends and fans and probably some guys who worked on your cars?
It's a great thing. And I got some friends here to come up from Florida, believe it or not, to see this here. And to my surprise, that I just found out, I just came here a little while ago. And I think it's a great thing. Just to see the people that we were involved with, they still remember us. So that means a lot to me.
It seemed like for a long time in this area, we didn't pay a lot of attention to history or the guys who had come and gone, but now it seems like in the last few years that's really taken off. Is that a neat thing for you?
Yeah, it is, really. I mean, maybe my ego is, gets worked up, but, you know, I like to hear things. People talk about you and they say things to you that you don't realize it, what you did. You know, you realize it, but you don't hear it. And then now all of a sudden they're starting to say different things about you, which is good. I love it.
Is it amazing sometimes to stop and think of what not just you, but guys like you meant to so many people on Saturday nights?
Yeah, it meant a lot to them. That's like our feeling, you know. Maybe at the time when we were doing it, we didn't feel that way, but now you hear about it. And it brings back old memories, different things that you did. Drivers, they talk about things that happened, and then you laugh about it. You know, like I used to have run-ins with a lot of drivers. But in the meantime, a lot of those drivers I met off the track, and they got to be my best friends. But then when I was in that car, they weren't my friends. I mean, they were my friends, but, you know, we're racing, and that's it.
Did you have a favorite racetrack?
Yeah, I had a favorite racetrack, which was Riverside. You know, I had good luck there, and it's just something that West Haven was good to me, but Riverside was a little better. I got more recognition there, and it seemed as I went into the years, I got more recognized. Which I think it was great. Then that when they picked me in one of the top 25 modified drivers of the 20th century, that was a great honor that I'll remember the rest of my life.
How about being in the near Hall of Fame? I mean, not just at Hall of Fame dinners, but at things like this. You're in pretty select company.
Oh, yeah. It's great. When I first got in, I said, all these other drivers, you know, like Jocko and Tappet and all them guys, they should have been in there before me, you know, because I used to look up to them guys. And they asked me, you know, they said to me that they were going to put me in, and that there was my biggest thrill in racing. You know, my biggest thrill in racing was winning a 500-lap team race with Jocko. And then the Racing Hall of Fame, then this, you know, that was a great honor. Then the 20th century, you know, that was just, I ain't much for, you know, I can talk, I can say a lot of things, you know, about what I did and, what, you know, this, that. But my feelings in racing was first with me all the time.
When you pull into a place like this, and you have won a ton of races here, or when you used to go to Riverside when it was still open, what goes through your mind when you turn into the parking lot or when you walk into the pits?
I sort of cleared everything out of my mind, and I wanted to just remember what I was going to do when I get into the car. Once I get into the car, I had nothing else but to see who was ahead of me, that I had a pass, and how they drove. And I had to figure out how to get by them. Because I know they were gonna start me in the tail end all the time. Not like today, they go by time trials. Even I think if they had time trials, you know, when I was doing it, I probably would have been in the back because I wasn't a time trialer. But it just seemed that when I was chasing somebody, I'd catch them. And I would go by them, because I had to figure out how I was going to get by them before I got to them.
How about even now when you look out at a place like this, what What does it do to you?
It does a lot. I want to really drive out there, do it, you know. But I know I can't. I could probably do it, but I don't want to take the chance of getting hurt, you know, and because there's no mending now. And that's my really reason now. But I think I could do it. I'm pretty sure I could do it.
But when you look out there, the competitive...
It's still in me, like, you know. And of course, you know, the people used to, you know, ray you and boo you, call you all kinds of names and everything, you know. Those things there were, you know, they're still there. They still yell at me and everything, you know. And I met the best people in the world in racing. Everybody was, you know, good to me. Nobody really treated me bad. The media was very good. All the promoters, you know, they loved to see me come because I used to bring a gang. And that's, you know, those things all come in. You know, you try to look back and, you know, it's just the way it is now.
Been a heck of a run, hasn't it?
Oh, yeah. But I loved every bit of it. Every bit of it. You know, I had a lot of people help me, a lot of guys. My brother, Ralph Solon. You know, we couldn't go to the races unless Ralph used to sort of set my car up for me, you know, near the end when I was running on my own. And he was good to me. He still is good to me, too. And, you know, we're close friends. My brother, he was the best mechanic around. He could touch a car and tell you what was wrong with it. Or he'd look at the car and he'd say, well, you're doing this wrong, you know, you're doing that wrong. But he didn't say what he was going to do. He used to do it. And then later he would tell me, well, how'd that work, you know, how'd this work? But it worked. Every time I took that car out for him, you know, we did good.
He just wanted you to worry about driving.
Yeah. That's how we came to that, I don't know if you ever knew about the pink car. That was one of my highlights, one of my good stories, too.
Go ahead, tell that one.
My brother, you know, the car, he said he couldn't see it. He says he couldn't see the car. He wanted to change the color. Now, they built a new car.
Uh-oh.
Now I'm in trouble. This is the greatest troublemaker around. And he's a great driver, too. He was a good competitor. Rene Charland. You know, that's my, yeah.
In front tell of, the story about the pink car, and then we'll talk.
All right. Here's a... come on. The pink car. My brother wanted to change the color so he could see the car better. So he said to the body man that was painting the car all the time, they just built a new car. He says, we're going to paint the car white. I happened to go in the garage that night, and I see the guy mixing the white paint. And I said to him, I says, what are you doing with that white paint? He says, I'm going to paint the car white. I said, no, you're not. We always had a red car, a metal flake red car, and that's got to be red. So he says, okay, started getting the red paint out, and I left. I came back the next day, and I opened the garage door. To my surprise, I seen a pink car there. So I said to him, Bill, what did you do? He says, you wanted red, your brother wanted white. I mixed them both together, and this is what came out, and that's what I shot it. That was the Pink Panther, they called it.
And guys like him never busted you for having a pink race car, did they?
Did they?
Oh, I love them.
They were ready to, you know, take me out. We had some great times. Rene Charland, we were in the All-Star League together, almost every race that we were in together. And that was, you know, a bunch of champion drivers from each track. And we raced dirt tracks and asphalt tracks. We were in I'll never forget this. We were in Nazareth, Pennsylvania. 10,000 people there that day, and they introduce you to the crowd. So Rene Charlene used to pick out of the hat just before me all the time. There's time he picked his number out of the hat from Bob O'Rourke, and now it's my turn. I go up there, I put my hand in to get my number, and Rene Charlene comes up behind me and grabs my hair and pulls it off of my head. I had a hairpiece on in front of 10,000 people. I wanted to kill them.
10,001.
Yeah, that's because you brought one of your girlfriends with you.
And you guys were still friends after that?
Oh, yeah, we were good friends.
Well, why fight?
Then he pulled a lot of tricks on me.
But at least Stafford, but he never cheated on the racetrack, did he?
I don't know if he never cheated, because he was a fast driver, and I was a fast driver, but he always had that little more to me on the asphalt, and I think he was cheating. I'm pretty sure he was cheating.
No, I wouldn't cheat. Do you think I'd do that to my friends?
But I wasn't your friend at the time.
Oh, okay. Well, then
you know, all the $15 and the $5 and the $10 that you used to have in your hand, the number that you were going to pick out of the hat. Oh, let's double up the bet tonight, you know, because whoever gets the pole, you know, you get double. Oh, yeah, okay, we're at his brother-in-law's track up in Albany Saratoga Speedway. He pulls out of the hat the pole. Yeah. The next night, we're at another place, he pulls the pole again. I had to pay him double, two nights in a row. But all the while, he had it in his hand before he put his hand in there.
No.
That's what you say. No, I know. You would never do that to me. You would never do nothing like that.
No.
What about at Stafford, what you did to me? I'm over there pulling, I put my hand in the thing, what do I come out? A rat trap. You know, he put the rat trap in there when he got his number out. He says, "Al Greco's next. Well, I'll get him. This is my track. I'm representing, you know, Stafford and the Speedway and the All-Star League." And Rene put the mouse trap. That's another. All my fans.
You pulled the trap out, didn't you? Hanging on your
finger. My finger was there, and the trap was hanging on my finger.
I thought that was pretty nice. The people liked it.
Yeah, I know that. I didn't.
There was a bunch of us who grew up around Riverside Park, literally and figuratively, at least in the sport of auto racing. We all came in with a great deal of enthusiasm, and I'm glad to say some of us are still here, including our next presenter. About the third year that I announced at the park, I was just out of college, and the Springfield newspapers had an opening for their auto racing columnist. The auto racing columnist of the Springfield paper was a position created by Ed Carroll, who owned Riverside Park, to placate Ed so that there would be news of the racetrack in the paper that would help support the generous advertising budget that Riverside Park had with the newspaper. So I applied for the job, went up, met Carol Robbins, the executive editor, and gave him my credentials and a sample of my writing, and he said, "We'll call you." And about 3 weeks later, I got a letter that said, "Thank you very much for your interest, but we have decided to hire a young gentleman by the name of Dean Nardi because of his special interest in journalism." And I gotta tell you, at the time, the words kind of stung, but every time I pick up an issue of Trackside, I find that he was right. Here is the editor of Trackside magazine, Dean Nardi, for our next presentation. Hello, y'all. There's been a tremendous amount of talented people that have been presented here today, and all very deserving. Just glad that the mere boy decided to save the best for last. That's how I feel about it anyway. It's just like having dessert after dinner. It's just the best part. And that's what it was like watching Billy Greco drive a race car. I came to realize that Billy Greco was something special back in the days Now, I talk about back in the days of Riverside Park. People up here have spoken about how commonplace Stafford was and Lowood and on and on and on. But let me tell you, Riverside Park was about as tough as they come. There was four heats, there was two semis, there was a consi, there was a B consi, and maybe you got into the main and you started from the rear of the handicap field, and it was tough racing. And the park was just a special place to be on Saturday nights for somebody growing up in the sport. It was a tough place. Drivers had their own sections in the grandstand. You had to keep them separated, and it was for a good reason, because it kind of cut down on the arrests and the hospitalizations. But Billy Greco, when he pulled that 43 out onto the track, whether it was for practice or for heat race or whatever, I mean, we knew what, just where the people stood, and half of them would stand up and they'd be yelling and screaming and cheering just like the troops had come home from the war. The other half, well, they were probably yelling some insults and throwing stuff, and it was just plain pandemonium. But I thought it was great. I mean, I'd never seen anything like it in my life. Probably never seen anything like that since. For years on a Saturday night, I never even had a date. We just couldn't miss Riverside Park. Billy Greco was the king of the Connecticut gang there. Most of them had names ending in vowels. It was Cambino, Godiosi, Galulu, Centenaro, Carangelo, Toro, on and on and on. But when I got to be 16 years old and got to go down and visit a little bit with the drivers, I met Billy Greco. And in the years that followed, Billy took me places that I had dreamed about and read about in the pages of Illustrated Speedway News, back when that was the only racing paper around. And I saw him drive for the Garrity brothers and their famous cars at Stafford and Thompson. I traveled the All-Star League circuit with Billy and went to many tracks throughout the Northeast for years. I went to Trenton and Langhorne, some of the tracks in Jersey like Old Bridge and Rich Bedoin's 500. But most importantly, I guess, and the thing I know Billy best of all for, and I'm sure many of you do, is the red metal flake coupe number 43 he drove for his brother George. Well, it was a red metal flake coupe most of the time. One year, the car was better known as the Pink Panther. Which there's a story behind that. And I guess George had decided that the car didn't show up that good on the racetrack. So he told the guy he was going to paint the car, well, we want to make it white this year. Well, that was all right. They got some white paint. Billy went into the garage the next night and heard that it was going to be white. He said, that's not going to work. This car has always been red metal flake, and that's what it's going to be. Go get some red metal flake paint. So the guy who was going to paint the car didn't know what to do. He had the white paint in one hand, he had the red paint on the other. So that night he mixed the two of them together, sprayed the car, voila, pink. And there was the Pink Panther. I'm not shy about saying that Bill Greco was my hero as a driver, but he became more than that as I knew him longer and longer. It was obvious to anybody that he had exceptional talent as a racer. But he was also a genuine person, one who was always willing to help out a friend or family member in times of need. Billy drove truck for a living for many years. He might get home at 4 a.m. from driving truck and get a call from somebody in distress, like the time one guy had a trailer come apart on the George Washington Bridge. That would be Mario Fiore and myself. Called to Billy Greco and he was right there to help. There's no way to get here today, and I figured it was because somebody called and broke down on 91 someplace and Billy went to get him. I mean, the numbers detailing Billy's accomplishments are tremendous. There's the park championships, the fact that he won a race at every track hosting modifieds in the state of Connecticut, on and on and on. They're all written down in the program. But what I'd like to add to that is Billy Greco, as I know him, was and is a personable, unassuming, and wonderful guy. Some people, later on in his career, used to call him Gramps. I called him Dad because, in reality, in my youth, Billy Greco was like a second father to me. I was speaking with Ralph Solem the other day, another another fellow, Billy, has driven for. And I think he put it best. He said, Billy Greco never had a big head. He just left a big footprint on New England racing. In my mind, there was no one better in his prime than Billy Greco. And that's why we're honoring him here today. So, Bill, you're the best. Come on up here. I want you to particularly note the headshot of Billy Greco.
Here, number two program, the number one
for me. Thank you. I just want to thank everybody. I really ain't a speaker or nothing, but there's so many people that I wanted to thank, all the owners that I drove for, different cars, my brother, George, who's right here, and Richard Bedine from the 500, and the guys that worked on the car through the years. I just want to thank everybody, all my fans that stuck with me. And, you know, every time I wave at Mike on television, he never waves back at me. My wife and my family that stuck by me. If I wasn't racing, I was working. I thought they knew where I was. Had a good times, a lot of good times. I could stay here all night and talk about different races and different things that I did and what I didn't do. All the competitors that I raced against, a lot of them are right here. I want to congratulate them all, Booker especially. You want your wrench back, I'll get it anytime you want it. I think my brother still got it. I want to thank all the drivers that I raced against too, that they backed off on me to let me win, you know, to let me get ahead of them. They used to put all our numbers on the wall, but they used to put the 43 in the dirt in the back. That's how far down I was all the time. Heats, semis, features, dead last. Today, they start on the pole. I think they're trying to get the guy that's running last. But whatever, it's all over. I enjoyed it. I met the best people in the world in the racing business. Everybody treated me good, and I try to treat them just as good as they treated me. Thank you for everything.
see trees of green, red roses too. I see them blue for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful
memory of sentimental verse, nothing in my purse, and chuckles when the preacher said, for better or for worse.
How lovely it was. Thanks for the memory of Schubert's serenade, little things of jade, and traffic jams and anagrams and bills we never paid.
How lovely it was. We who could laugh over big things were parted by only a slight thing.
I wonder if we did the right thing. Oh, well, that's life, I guess.
I love your dress.
Do you?
It's pretty.
Thanks for the memory of faults that you forgave, rainbows on a wave,
and stockings in the basement.